If I ask you to picture a Neanderthal, the image that you conjure up in your head might not be very flattering. Sloping brow, speaking only in grunts, maybe carrying a cartoonishly large club. Sound about right? Well, a slew of recent discoveries, just in the last 5 or 10 years, suggest that Neanderthals were anything but brutish cavemen. They lived in Europe from about 200,000 years ago to around the time that anatomically modern humans, that's us, showed up on the continent, roughly 40,000 years ago. And they're a lot less different from us than scientists used to think. In fact, many experts aren't even sure that Neanderthals and modern humans are different enough to be considered separate species. We now know, for example, that by the standards of 50 centuries ago, their technology was surprisingly advanced. Neanderthals made stone tools, but they didn't just pick a pointy rock up off the ground and tie it to a stick. The process of making stone tools involved a lot of steps and required practice and skill, from shaping pieces of rock into forms they wanted, known as knapping, to attaching the stone pieces to handles, known as hafting. Even more interesting, those knapped stones were sometimes glued to shafts using a sticky substance called pitch. Pitch is made from birch bark, but it's not easy to get out. The birch has to be heated in the absence of oxygen to over 400 degrees Celsius, a procedure that's finicky and difficult enough that archaeologists have had trouble replicating it. But pitch has been found at several Neanderthal sites, and chemical analysis shows that it was distilled from birch bark. Some archaeologists have said that this is evidence of the world's first industrial process. Just as remarkably, Neanderthals may have invented a tool that we still use today. It's called the lessoir, and it's used in leatherworking. It's kind of a smoother or burnisher designed to make leather hides tougher and more flexible. Neanderthals used lessoirs made of bone because it was more flexible than wood or stone, which wouldn't have gotten the job done. This shows they understood the materials they were using and altered them for special tasks. There's also some evidence among Neanderthals for what you might call culture. Many archaeologists think they buried their dead, for example, used pigments for painting, and made beads for decoration, although some experts aren't so sure. But maybe what's the most controversial about Neanderthals is whether they had the capacity for language. Unlike bones or stone tools, language doesn't fossilize, so scientists have had to get pretty creative in how they've looked for evidence of it. One clue has come from their skeletal anatomy. The hyoid bone, which supports the tongue, is necessary for human speech. And while other primates have this bone too, it's not positioned in the right way to make the kind of complex vocalizations that we can. But scientists in Australia created a computer model of the Neanderthal hyoid to simulate its movement, and their analysis showed that it could have been used in ways similar to ours. It doesn't prove that Neanderthals spoke, but it does show that maybe they could have, and yet another clue about whether Neanderthals used language can be found in their genome. One gene of particular interest here is known as FOXP2, which is known to be involved in language and cognition in many different animals. Songbirds need this gene in order to sing, and modern humans missing even a single copy of it can have trouble forming speech. But all modern humans have two small changes in that gene that we don't share with any other animal, including chimps. It's part of what sets our complex language abilities apart. A team of German scientists looked at the FOXP2 gene in the genome of the Neanderthals and found that they had the same two genetic changes. Now, if you've seen our episode on what we know about the sex lives of early humans, you know that modern humans and Neanderthals did a fair amount of interbreeding. But scientists don't think that this is how those genes got swapped. Instead, they believe that our earlier common ancestor must have passed those changes onto both of us. Now, other studies have found that there are still some differences between the FOXP2 gene that we have and the one that Neanderthals had. And language is way too complicated for a single gene to tell us all that much, really. So we may never know for certain whether Neanderthals could speak, but they definitely have more in common with us than we thought. They may have had technology, culture, and even language, and that kind of makes me wish they were still around so we could hang out. Play some video games. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow, brought to you by our patrons on Patreon. If you want to help us make more videos like this, you can go to patreon.com/scishow, and don't forget to go to youtube.com/scishow and subscribe.
Isolated pockets of hair. We actually have two species of lice. We have head lice, and we have pubic lice.
And that's different from every other mammal's lice. But our pubic lice?